Hello and welcome back to another Global Street Food Challenge. Today though, we have a very special guest. It's Kevin from the Let's Cook channel. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for being here.
This is amazing to be here with you.
Yes,
look at this.
I like this a lot.
How good are you at A, eating, and B, geography?
I'm pretty good at eating, and I also enjoy tasting the food that I eat a lot. And then geography, I don't know, I guess we'll see. I do a lot of stuff around the world. So you would think that maybe I would know this, but yeah, I'm not confident.
We do a lot of stuff from around the world, but I'm still terrible at this game.
Yeah, so who knows?
Bring on round one. The first dish is in front of you, and you can remove your blindfolds.
Oh. Oh, wow.
Wait, this looks very familiar.
It does look very familiar.
Now, all we ask of you is to scribble down one country, the location of this particular dish.
Wait, before you bite into it, what do you think is going to be inside?
It's either cheesy potato or meat-based.
I do think it's like a meat-based thing, yeah.
All right, cheers. So as you might imagine, this is sometimes served as a side or as a snack in itself. You might find it in the drinking establishments of this country.
So potato, meat, I'm gonna go for beef.
You think there's mashed potato in here?
I think there's potato in there.
Yeah, it's like all bind it together by potato.
You're pretty much spot on. Cottage pie. Basically, it's minced beef, potato, onion, carrot, all the things that we would typically put in a cottage pie have ended up inside this filling, but there are lots of different fillings that you might find for this dish from where it comes from.
This sauce, to me, tastes so familiar, but I just can't place the taste. Can you place the taste?
That is such a better name for this game.
Place the taste.
That is such a better name for these videos.
After about 8 episodes, Kevin, you just renamed it.
Yeah, I think I'll just go sauce, just straight up sauce. The sauce to me has the key.
Now remember the rules. If you can get the country spot on, you will get 5 points. However, if you're both wrong, we will look at who is closest from the centroid of each country and then give 1 point to the closest.
If we're both wrong, we fight. I have a little instinct.
I've got an instinct, but this could go in a few different directions.
Exactly.
This dish was introduced to this country by the French.
Oh,
hence the pané.
I wish I knew enough history to know what that means.
That's either helped you or confused you. But I need you to lock in an answer. Yep, so this is minced beef.
We can't peek, right?
No.
Bound with mashed potato. Sometimes you get them with shrimp or with cheese. Sometimes you get them with almost like a curry filling.
I know when he's going to say the answer, I'm going to be like, oh yeah, I should have known that.
Yeah, that's the horrible, that's why I hate these games so much, but I also love them because of the delicious food.
Exactly.
We always learn something. You both locked in an answer. If you can reveal them in 3, 2, 1, go. We've got Lebanon.
I said Lebanon.
And Jay is going for the UK.
Oh.
Explain your logic.
So me, I remember making this one dish called kibbeh from Lebanon, and it had a very similar nature in the filling, and it was also deep fried.
Oh, that's really interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was yours? But
you seem more confident.
You're far more traveled than I am.
I don't know. Jay hasn't left his own borders, and I'm guessing has said this is a cottage pie that the French panned.
Because we also panned Scotch eggs. The filling is very cottage pie-esque. There's no other flavorings in the filling, which makes it quite plain British food. And the sauce is very, very reminiscent of H.P. Brown sauce.
And so, H.P. Brown.
Yeah, it's kind of got that vinegary, the Worcestershire.
Right.
Wash your sister sauce.
I'm going to reveal that you are both wrong.
Okay. Well, we're not both going to be right, are we?
However, the clues were there. They are panko breadcrumbs. This is a tonkotsu sauce. Oh. This is karake from Japan.
So definitely, surely.
Wow.
So this is a fantastic snack. I said drinking establishments because I didn't want to say izakaya, but they would have been served in sort of Japanese pubs, but also sometimes alongside other dishes in restaurants. And they can have all sorts of filling, but it was the French influence. It originated in French cuisine, came across at the start of the 1900s.
Wow. Just a tonkatsu sauce.
So it was the sauce. It was the sauce that had the key. Because to me, the filling here does not feel very Japanese.
No, it doesn't give anything away.
Exactly. Yeah.
Which is why I went British.
So probably don't need to tell you who is closest on that round, but just for giggles, Jay, you are 9,224 miles away.
It's pretty close, man.
Kevin, much closer with a mere 5,403 miles away.
That's pretty much nothing.
Oh, neither of us shone in glory.
Yeah, there, not yet.
But you were slightly more glittery than I was.
Exactly.
Which means, Kevin, you get the point, and we move on to round two. Round number two. Let's see how we get on with this one.
Oh, wow.
Whoa.
What?
Oh. I'm not going to give away anything.
Yep.
I'm not going to give anything away.
We genuinely didn't know this when we set this one up, but whilst you had your blindfolds on and we were getting sexies, we had a little giggle on the sidelines.
Well, I'm going to sit back and let you have some fun with this, and I will enjoy.
So grated cheese, a white sauce, and is that bread underneath?
Is it?
Is it?
Maybe it's not. Who knows?
Cheers.
Cheers. Oh yeah.
We should stress that Kevin probably has a better idea of what this is. It's not the plan. We didn't know this.
I'm trying to work out what the white sauce is on the top. It's a bit like Greek yogurt-y.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Greek. Yogurt.
Ooh.
So it is a yeasted dough that's rolled out and then fried, often then rubbed with a little bit of garlic, but like a clove to give you that sort of garlic scent. And then that thing on top, Jay, is sour cream. And on top of that, cheese.
Usually I'd expect the fried bread to be more sweet because of that donut type consistency.
Exactly, yeah.
But the sour cream and the cheese is really nice. I'm just perplexed by it.
Is it fair to say that this is quite a simple classic version, but there might also be other toppings added? So it might also carry some onions, maybe some ham and some
this
meat.
This is a turnaround for the book.
Yeah, well, I realized it's not the way we planned this.
This is my favorite way to have this.
Well, perhaps, Jay, you can lock in an answer.
Oh.
And Kevin, see if you can work out where in the world maybe, you can place the taste.
Maybe I'm wrong, who knows?
You could well be.
Exactly.
So our wonderfully golden fried crisp bread on the outside and nice and light on the inside, sour cream and cheese, a little bit of garlic, comes from, turn around in 3, 2, 1.
For me, it was 50-50. It was either going to be Romania or the Netherlands.
Oh,
you're from Romania, but you live in the Netherlands.
Exactly.
So I had to decide which direction to go in. It turns out neither of them are right.
But what you don't know about me is that I have Hungarian blood.
And we did not know that either, which is why this game has slightly gone wrong.
I'm sorry, but my mom is Hungarian.
Well, that's amazing. In which case, tell us more about this dish.
Yeah, so this is langos. I hope that's how you call it. I will say it's a little harder than I usually have it, but then it's topped with sour cream, garlic, and cheese, and sometimes just a sprinkle of salt. And you eat it piping hot as it comes out.
And our understanding is the name comes from the word for flame, which is why it's cooked in sometimes the oven as well. So people would come to a communal oven to cook their version of it as opposed to the fried version. So there's kind of different traditions, the fried or the baked version.
Oh, I didn't know that.
But the garlic, the sour cream, the cheese on the kind of leavened flatbread is the way forward.
It is absolutely delicious.
Oh, yeah.
And knowing that a bit like pizza, you can have the different toppings, you can try it in different ways.
Yeah.
It sounds really versatile. Can I make a suggestion that next time we have a guest in this format, we get them to do an ancestry DNA test first?
So I can send in my blood samples, my saliva.
To be fair, he's only taking a leaf out of your book. You put UK in the first answer. We don't need to do the mileage on this one. Kevin absolutely takes.
Thank you.
Full marks, 5 points, which puts him at 6-0.
Ooh, sorry.
All to play for in
it
the last
It feels
two
a little
rounds.
Bit unfair.
It is still all to play for as we move into round three.
Let's get some mushy peas in here, guys.
Fish and chips.
Yeah.
Okay, the third one is in front of you. Blindfolds off.
Exciting.
Pull it back. Woo!
Similar colour, very different.
Interesting.
It's got hot dogs in it.
Doesn't it kind of look like an empanada?
It does look quite empanada-y.
Yeah.
It's bread.
Wait, what?
It's bread.
There's hot dogs in here. I'm seeing onions, or what is that? Yeah, onions, mustard.
Oh, there's a
jam?
What is it? Steam coming out of Jay's. Still hot.
There's like stuffing in it. There's rice.
Rice?
What the f- is this?
This is like a bunch of cultures just clashed together and formed this.
I have a taste, dig in. You're pretty right though. It's kind of a bread dough that has been wrapped around a filling. Sometimes it's pork, sometimes it's beef, sometimes it's a mixture of pork and beef. This is pork.
This doesn't come together for me. It doesn't feel like a dish. It feels like a random thing. Like AI generated this.
Yeah.
You haven't sort of got to the filling yet, which naturally, obviously, you would eat the whole thing. And
oh, you feel that spice in there?
You've got like sage and onion stuffing in there. It feels like what you'd stuff a turkey with. I'm so confused.
Yeah, it feels sagey.
You know, like a Cornish pasty used to be split into two parts, so you'd have the savory part and the sweet part.
What is that? I don't even know what that is.
When we go down to the mines, they'd have a pasty, and on one side it would have meat and potato.
Okay.
And on the other side, it would have jam or something sweet in it, so that they had lunch and pudding in one handy,
that's smart,
handheld meat packet.
This dish quite literally translates to meat pie. It is, in our instance, a pork sausage filling with rice, onion, inside bread dough, which is kind of then folded and crimped over and then fried. Once that's done, it's then cut into, and then we put in frankfurter or wiener or hot dogs, mustard, ketchup, and raw onion.
That feels so strange. Because to me, this part and this part feel like two different places in the world.
I'm really enjoying it.
Yeah, it's not bad.
It's really unusual because of the mixture of flavors.
Mm-hmm. One thing it hasn't got in it is egg.
Egg?
There's definitely no egg in this. And for those of you who do know the dish, you'll know why that's important.
No egg. What country hates eggs?
So there is an old joke that some of the traditional cafeterias and street food vendors who would serve this, the server would ask, would you like it with egg? And you're supposed to respond no with money. And I think the translation is, do you want to sort of pay with it by egg as opposed to money? And that's because egg is slang for penis in this particular place. I don't know if that helps narrow it down.
So it's not an English speaking country. At least we know that.
No.
So you have to translate it.
Yes.
Yes.
And this dish translates to meat pie.
I think it's first of all, this culture likes to have fun. We can establish that.
Yeah.
Yes. Like you look at this and they're like, these people are fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right, see if you can scribble down a country.
I don't even know which continent to aim for.
Same.
Right. I'm sticking a pin in a map.
And that is why we love this particular video game, because this was completely new to all of us. We're learning too. Spin your boards in 3, 2, 1. Switzerland and Brazil.
Did I spell this correctly, first of all?
I would have gone for a Z rather than an S. But no, they might spell it that way.
Okay, okay. So for me, I picked a country that just was a clash of, not a clash, but a mixture of European cultures, because the hot dog in there, the mustard, it just felt like a European thing to me. So I was just like, okay, Switzerland, they have fun.
I tried to think of a country that has rice in its culture and like meats like sausage and that kind of thing, is out there, but also puts things in bread.
So I can reveal with my poor pronunciation that this is the Harpiraka.
Oh, that's European. That's Swedish or something.
It's Finnish.
Oh!
This is from Finland.
Oh!
Yes! At least a little bit of my instincts were good.
Finland did come to my mind, but I dismissed it because I couldn't think of any reason why it would be Finnish.
Because I also thought about Finland, but I was like, they definitely have fish or some fishy thing in there.
Do you think that
Kev, you're about
closer?
5 times closer than Jamie, who was 6,685 miles away.
Can we check the math on that? Because I'm not too sure.
Lihapiraka translates to meat pie, and it very much is a fried meat pie filling. It does bounce between pork or beef filling. And you're right, I think the closest part of that was the mustard and the kind of the wiener or the frankfurter kind of vibe goes in the middle. But they also sometimes add mushrooms, sometimes add some cheese. It's a real hodgepodge of street food delights.
When I first bit into it, I was like, it doesn't make sense, but the more I ate it, the more I wanted to finish it, so.
Finish it.
Yes.
Oh no. There you go.
Kevin, at the moment you have 7 points, which I think is about the highest of anybody of all time on this particular game. And there's still a round to go.
Wow.
Round number four.
If you're enjoying this, there are some small things you can do that make a big difference to us. Like the video. Subscribe if you aren't. Click the notification bell and select all. Thanks.
Last one. Remove the blindfolds. These smell so good.
Ooh. That. Meat on a skewer.
Possibly yes. A hot skewer. See if you can identify any of the flavors and the meat itself.
Smell any spices? I think this smells like lamb, maybe.
I'm getting fennel seeds or cumin seeds on there.
It looks very spiced up.
It does look very spiced up,
and I like that. Mm. You think it's lamb?
Mm-hmm. Cumin? Cumin.
Definitely cumin. Oh, yeah. Or is it fennel? Oh, wow.
Seeds, chili
so
flakes.
Far, you're a bit unsure whether it's cumin or fennel. I can tell you it's both.
Okay.
Oh. So well done.
Nice.
It is also lamb.
Very tender.
Spiced up lamb on a skewer.
Yeah.
Sometimes they would be sort of wooden sticks, bamboo skewers. Sometimes they're metal. The bamboo, obviously, perhaps more traditional on the streets, so you can take them away and you don't have to bring back the metal skewers. But the metal skewer, perhaps more in more of the restaurant setting.
I think a lot of cultures do this style of street food, so I think it's a little difficult.
One thing I will say,
more clues.
This dish is believed to have originated from some of the nomadic traditions of people within this country who relied heavily on animal husbandry for their sustenance. And then obviously the skewering of meat is something that could be done easily while in motion. Now, a street food stand is static and you come to it, but this was a way of being able to move and skewer meat as you move and not have to carry too many pots and things like that. Right, you've both scribbled something down. Turn your boards around in 3, 2, 1.
Ba-ba-ba-ba.
Oh! Oh!
Look at that!
We both win!
Yeah! Oh, that means I can't win!
You are both as close or as far as each other. What are the chances of that?
I just felt like I saw a lot of lamb dishes in that northern African part of the world. And just the skewerness of it, and then the nomadic people that you mentioned, it just all connected with me. I don't know why.
Yeah, I was going lamb, that spicing sort of blend was very... And then the other one was turkey. Because
I also thought of turkey.
A big country. I just thought, if we're going off Istanbul, and it's over there, then, you know, from the centroid's perspective, I'm well amiss.
You are both well amiss.
Oh, well amiss.
However, the logic is very strong. So this is from predominantly Muslim communities. The cumin and the lamb is also associated with a number of dishes in the area. This was originally from the Xinjiang region, but the dish is called chan.
What?
And it is from China.
What?
What?
So close to Nepal and kind of the spicing of biang biang noodles, if you remember the cumin lamb and the chili.
Wow, I would have never guessed that.
I would never associate like the spices of like cumin and fennel with
Me neither.
Chinese.
So fennel, one of the Chinese five spices.
Well, apart from that one, yeah.
And cumin, and it is the Muslim community and often the Muslim quarter, sort of north, west of the country. So you were both 5,139 miles away.
Yes.
But that means you were both equally far and take a point each. So it finishes 8-1.
Yes.
Kevin, what a win.
Yes.
Oh, I mean, I didn't get zero, but
thank you for being happy for me.
Well, I am happy for, I was happy for me as well, but I'm mainly happy for you. That thank is, you. You've come in and absolutely stonked that.
Wow.
Yeah.
I did not expect that, but I had a very good time. Thank you for having me.
Well, Kevin, thanks for joining us, for playing along. While Kevin was here, he has also done a sub-10-minute burger challenge. The question is, was he sub-10 minutes? You'll have to watch it to find out. But thank you so much for joining us. Check out everything from the Let's Cook channel in the links downstairs.
Subscribe to Sorted Food. A lot.
A lot. Congratulations.
Nicely done.
Well done.
Thank you, guys.